Well, I started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing.
And a smiling Manny Franco moments ago aboard Tis the Law, about a week out from the Travers with him running in the Midsummer Derby. And here locally at Gulfstream Park, final preparations have already taken place as we settle in for a 10 race, July 31st. A little bit of a finality feeling in the air, considering we do close down the month of July in 2020. But hard to argue with that live scenery from the clubhouse turn. Turf, in fact, wins the majority on the program. Six turf races, four over the main track, and it's good to have you with us, everybody, on this live Friday edition of Gulfstream Park today. Jason Blewett, once again, from our third floor clubhouse studios. And although we are really starting to hit the heart of the summer down here at Gulfstream Park, not a time to get just midsummer doldrums. This is a solid Friday program and then some. And as we bring in Ron Nicoletti downstairs in our paddock set studio, Ronnie, I mean, tomorrow might be the biggest day we've had locally at Gulfstream Park since Tis the Law won the Florida Derby with the opening round of the Florida Sire Stakes.
Yeah, the Florida Sire Stakes starts tomorrow. They'll be going six furlongs for the fillies, mares, the Dr. Fager. We'll just see. This time of the year is what I really like, because we always mention this. You never know if you're going to see one of these two-year-olds go on to do great things. So it's a great time of the year. I love this part of the season.
Yeah, absolutely. In both those Florida Sire Stakes, the Desert Vixen and the Fager drew big fields, and they're competitive on that 11 race Saturday program. Meanwhile, we start a new weekend. We wonder if this is the calm before the storm. Fingers crossed as far as Mother Nature is concerned, but we can guarantee a round of the Stronach 5 this afternoon. We've got that $100,000 guarantee and a start time of about 3:20, 3:25 Eastern up at Laurel Park in race number 6.
Yeah, a little different sequence. We're a B end. We're the final leg this week because we've got a 10-race card this afternoon, but three from Laurel, two from right here at Gulfstream Park, races 8 and race 10 from here.
Now, moving forward again, 11 here tomorrow, 10 today, 10 on Sunday afternoon, and potentially with some rainfall, who knows what the forecast will actually be or turn out to be. But I'll tell you, Ronnie, in looking at Sunday's 10-race card, I don't remember a time I've seen 9 dirt races on one particular program.
Well, of course, we're being careful. We don't know what the storm that's coming going to bring, if it's going to bring rain at all. I've been here many, many years, and we were going to have a storm come in, and all of a sudden it makes a right turn and goes somewhere else. So I'm going to wait and see how this thing plays out.
That's a good rule of thumb, my friend. And a plan of attack, Tropical Storm Isaias. I had asked Ronnie about an hour and a half ago what the correct pronunciation was, and he shrugged his shoulders. Did a little research. Isaias, my friend.
Is that a name? It's supposed to be a name?
I guess so. I guess it's a name. Kind of reminds me of back in the day trying to pronounce Fusaichi Pegasus.
That was a tough one for me,
too.
Still is.
I'm in the club, my friend. Desert Vixen Field, let's check it out. We've got trainer Dan Pita sending out the favorite in Princess Secret. Nice. I spoke to Dan yesterday because he's got a really talented two-year-old Florida-bred filly by Kozan. You'll hear part of that interview a bit later today and the rest tomorrow in the lead up to the Desert Vixen. Got to tell you, first time speaking, Ronnie, with Dan in person, as he's got Princess Secret at 2-1 with Miguel Vasquez. Real nice guy, and again, he has got a filly who, along with Day Out of the Office, I think she's in the top two with the youngsters we've seen so far on this circuit.
Yeah, she's run exceptionally well in those two races. So we'll see Princess Secret. Just a great race and wide open. If you think you can beat her, there's a lot of different ways to go. I told you yesterday, I got a little interest in that maiden up there, number one, Freak, just to hit the board tomorrow at a price.
Yeah, Freak is coming out of a race we will see Con Lima and Happy Constitution returning out of in the fourth. I've got a replay pulled for that, so sit tight. And that fourth race, in fact, obviously a part of Friday's Fast and Firm early pick five and pretty competitive turf sprint. As I was saying with the open, this will begin the turf procession. We've got six individual grass races, and I'm a 4, 5, and 8 in this first race on this Friday afternoon. And I put most of my stock in horses that have just run consistently well or respectably well for the level on the turf thus far. I used a couple in the second race, a race undoubtedly centered upon the number 2 First Navy Admiral, likely going to be a big favorite. And again, if he wires, that won't shock me at all. I almost singled him. I've got 3 in the third. I wonder if Kayseri, who may be around 6-5, could be a bit vulnerable, and I'll talk about her when we get up to that race. And in regards to the whole Bodemeister freak race, Ronnie, I like Con Lima this afternoon, returning off a fairly auspicious debut for trainer Carlos David. I really like the way she finished up in that July 11 career debut.
Yeah, she's my top selection in there. You know, definitely a good single for you this afternoon.
Now, what are you doing in the first? Because I'm 3 deep, and evidently, I don't know if I missed. I don't think I missed the number 1, Saucy Tune. She is a contender here. You left her out as well. She's bet early, and it's probably mostly due to the drop. I mean, she's first time 12-5 maiden claiming for Joe Orsino and Amisael. But like I was saying, I feel as though the likes of Miranda Sophia, the 4, the 5 Aunt Irene, but Christian for Diane Marici, and our top pick, the 8 Platinum Sense, all 3 of those fillies have run respectably well on the turf, and I sided with the horses I thought had the best grass form.
Yeah, you know, the one horse in here, the Saucy Time, I just wanted to watch one with that big drop for Joe Orsino. I did go with Platinum Sense. We're actually have almost the same, well, we have the same almost try, just flip-flop our second choices. Platinum Sense, 2 for 2 in the money at the distance on the turf. Goes back to the grass today. Stalked the pace, finished that distant third. That was going 6 on the dirt. Amando de la Cerda, you got Edgar Zayas, surface switch this afternoon. Aunt Irene has another been knocking on the door in those turf races. And Miranda Sophie is hoping to get away from the, you know, trouble free. Got mugged at the start last time out. So I did the same thing you did. Horses that I thought ran okay on the turf at this level is the horses that I used.
Now, we hit the main for race number 2, which is a 2-year-old $16,000 maiden claimer. And it's a different race, but I get the same kind of like vibes that I had yesterday, and a lot of people evidently had, because she was around 6-5 or even money with the Ralph Nix train Don't Eat the Apple, who looked like she was going to get the lead. And would it be a question of would she wire and hold on? And obviously, she was one of 6 winning favorites on yesterday's card. And I think the real, for me anyway, the dividing line in the sand with the number 2 First Navy Admiral for Ralph is, I just see this colt getting loose, Ronnie. I don't love him, but I think he controls it. I think he's a hard horse to cut down.
Yeah, you know, drop it to the 16 level today after setting the pace a weekly late to finish 3rd and 2nd, respectively, against those $25,000 types. Ralph Nix, he's got his go-to guy, MSCL Harrow. Me, I like that horse a lot too. On top of my ticket, like yours, I did use the 8 Mondays with Mike in 2nd, who's dropping to this level, rallied to finish. I thought it improved the 4th behind First Navy Admiral last time out for Kathleen. Edgar Zayas handling the rematch today. That's the way I saw the race.
Well, yeah, I mean, that is in taking things a step further with Ralph's horse. You've got 3 rematching off that July 10th race. And of, again, we both like Ralph's horse, but in the race to potentially run 2nd, I did not like watching that race Mondays with Mike. I didn't like his effort at all. I just didn't think he ran in that race. I'm thinking the 7 Mighty Thomas, 2nd out for Antonio, is going to run far better. I wrote no speed, sluggish start inside. I think he steps forward this afternoon, and we'll see if he bridges the gap on First Navy Admiral. Back to the turf we go for race number 3, which is a 12-5 to 10-5 3-year-old filly claimer. We'll dive into the pre-race keys in a race that quite simply rests upon Kayseri. She was good last out, and I feel as though, in hindsight, that was probably one of the smartest, best rides of any jockey here in the colony, with Sammy Camacho taking the lead and showing that initiative and just daring to be great in that spot. Yet, I think this afternoon, the pace and the trip Kayseri pulled last time out, I just don't see it happening again. And although Midnight Gem has her flaws, I think she may be in a good spot this afternoon, and I'm going to try her for the rematch. But, you know, getting back to that original bullet, because this race is about Kay Sari, who may be around 6-5 or even money because her last race was such a high watermark to this field, I wanted to go and from the gate basically into the clubhouse turn run, just look at Sammy's ride aboard this filly for trainer Bob DeBona. And you can see him basically shake the reins at her, and he's intent, Ronnie, at this point, at getting her to the point.
Yeah, he just got it to the point. It was a really nice ride, as you mentioned, with Kasari. And I like the fact that this horse is turning back to the mile this afternoon after that sharp outing you're looking at going that mile in the 16th. She led every step of the way, as you mentioned, Jason, and just ran a really, really nice race. I'm going to try and see if this horse can do two in a row. Now, there is, as you said, other speed in this race. Maybe she doesn't get an easy lead like last time.
She can rate. I mean, she broke her maiden here for maiden 16 right around Florida Derby time, tracking as more of an outside pressing speed, so she's not a need the lead type. But I am going into this thing thinking she might be, just because she got the good ride and had everything her own way, she might be a little dressed up, as they say. And if that's the case, Midnight Gem, due to the presence of Marie's Melody, the 3 Foxy Lady, and the 8 Queen Feld, or Field that is, in that first flight department, I would love to see Midnight Gem go back to more of those plotting tactics, 2 back, where she just laid back. I think they tried to keep her a little closer last time, and she just didn't kick on. I'm going to try her from off the pace. You obviously like the favorite.
Yeah, look, I like the favorite. But Midnight Gem is going to turn back to the 8 furlongs today. As you mentioned, stalked and finished 4th behind Kasari, going the mile in the 16th. Leonel Reyes in the satellite closed it out with the 8 Queen Feld, who's dropping today to the 12-5 level again. Set the pace, faded. Does that go horse go up and look Kayseri in the eye? And I think you made a great point. I don't know if the 7 needs to lead just to win. I think this horse can rate.
Yeah, if she rates and runs back to her last performance, she's going to be a handful here. But I think there's enough going on as far as company early where a couple of the more plotting late running types may get a look in that race at bigger prices, at least as far as I'm concerned. Back on the main for the 4th. We go 7 here, and as the seasons progress, these 2-year-old races on the dirt anyway have gotten slightly longer and longer, and now we're at 7 furlongs, and the trip going 7/8 in my mind is going to help Con Lima and perhaps Happy Constitution. And we'll backtrack to their respective career debuts. They are the first fillies on the dirt, mind you, coming out of this race. And at this point, they were basically racing in tandem as a team with Con Lima in the white and polka dot cap there. I like the silks on the 3 Con Lima. This horse was able to corner just a bit better in what the 4 path there and got the jump on Happy Constitution. You will see, though, Con Lima quite green in mid-stretch here. Little hesitant switching leads, drifted in behind the Arundel horse Freak, who's running in the Desert Vixen, and Happy Constitution, meanwhile, will duck in. And both these fillies ran okay first out.
Yeah, and they ran okay. And, I did go with Con Lima for all the reasons you mentioned, but I wanted to show a stat on the number 7 Happy Constitution. This one from Antonio Santa with his 2-year-olds making their second start on the maiden special weight conditions. He's 8-37, 22%, 41% in the money. And he's got a real nice return of investment of $3.18. So there is reason to believe that this horse is going to take that jump forward this afternoon. Con Lima and Happy Constitution look like the logical 2 in the particular race, and to see the stat up there. And I close it out with West Side Girl, who can certainly be the story when she turns back to 7 on the grass after finishing. That was going that 2-turn mile on the turf, Kenny McPeak, MSCL Jaramillo.
Yeah, what do you make of her trying the dirt off? A fair career debut on the turf where Spanish Love Affair was at GPW and the rest were over here. I mean, she was beaten by a filly from Mark Cassie that I would imagine is on her way to Saratoga for one of those late summer 2-year-old turf stakes. What do you make of West Side Girl, though, trying the dirt?
I think they wanted to try her on the turf first time out. Maybe that was the race that filled. Maybe they want to see if she can sprint on the dirt now in just her second start. And Kenny McPeak, not great numbers, but solid numbers with going from turf to dirt. And we'll see how this horse runs. You know, if this horse thought it showed more speed last time out. I'd be a little more interested in her, but West Side Girl on both of our tickets.
I wonder if Kenny wanted distance with her first out, where when she debuted even a few weeks ago, we were not running 7/8 races on the dirt. And I wonder if he felt maybe 6 or 6.5 or 5.5 on the dirt ultimately was just going to be too short for this filly by Shanghai Bobby. We'll see how she does. We'll take a little breather here and we'll chase a big Rainbow Six jackpot after this.
Three Rules takes charge. Three Rules leads it by a length and a half. Blessed Halo is second. Awesome Standard and Cinderella El Chrome followed by Front Loaded and Jewel Heist as they turn for home in the Dr. Fager. And there goes Three Rules. He's past the furlong grounds, widening on a four-length lead. Blessed Halo trying to hold on to second, then Front Loaded and Awesome Standard. But Three Rules is simply awesome. It's Three Rules and Cornelio Velasquez wrapped up and six in front. Blessed Halo second, Front Loaded third. Jewel Heist finished fourth and 109-2.
It's funny, Ronnie. That race basically on its four-year anniversary with Three Rules. That was his third lifetime start. He was unbeaten to that point and was a big 3-5 favorite in the 2016 Dr. Fager. And that was my final summer living and working in New York before moving down here. And it's funny, going back to the time, I remember hearing, oh, there's a Florida bred who was an absolute monster down at Gulfstream Park, and it turned out to be Three Rules.
Yeah, he swept the Florida Cyrus Hicks Series. Now, things have not gone the way they would like. In his subsequent, you know, three-year-old year and four-year-old year, he just said not the same horse as he was when he was a two-year-old, but boy, was he impressive.
He was a powerhouse for trainer Jose Pinchon. Now, I don't know if we have a Three Rules or even chance it to this point, looking at the cast of 12 tomorrow in the $100,000 Dr. Fager, but I feel pretty comfortable saying that Breeze on By is a deserving morning line favorite for Ralph Nix, Jax or Better, and Amisael Jaramillo. And he, along with Papa Two, who's not eligible for this series because he's a Kentucky bred by Dialed In, they're the two best juvenile males I've seen so far. And there's that cast of 12.
Yeah, Breeze on By, just really impressive winning its debut, first race and debut by six lengths. Just looks like one of those type of horses that has a lot of upside. And boy, you can't go wrong with having Ralph Nix training your two-year-olds.
No, Ralph and Jax are Better have won a number of Florida Sire Stakes. In fact, Jax are Better, I think, holds the record. It's a big number, and we'll have clarification on that by tomorrow for sure with Breeze on By going from stall two with the Misael in the Dr. Fager. Again, though, that is down the line in a little more than 24 hours from now. Today, we've got 1.1, I think, in the jackpot guarantee. I'm wondering off the bat, I know you don't like the single early, Ronnie, but did you stand alone with Maverick Kitten here?
I did not, and I wanted to. I hate to get knocked out in the first leg, so I did go, which happened to me yesterday, and then I had the rest of the day. It was a good day, but I got knocked out. I Maverick Kitten certainly want to be, but I also use Fake Muse. Oh, no, this last time, this gelding faced Claimers. He finished third at the $65,000 level. We'll talk more about that horse.
He's got speed, too, Ronnie.
Yeah. And then in race number six, I think Combination Take Charge, dude. The first off the claim by Peter Walder. Are the logical two in there. I like Deender in race number seven at 10-1, hoping to get a little price. Going back to the turf for Mark Cassie, La Russia and Katz, J&J on my ticket. And then my actual best bet today, and I don't know until I see the morning line, was in race number eight is the six Kunal, who's 10-1 on the line for Louis Rysel. I thought this horse ran good coming in from the fairgrounds to run well. So I got a bit of a price also in race number eight, too deep in race Revolution number 9, Violent Trick, and Ali Z. And in the last, wide open affair. A lot of horses have speed, but they haven't run on the turf that much.
All right, fair enough. A Violent Trick going to start as the favorite in our featured 9th. Compact field, but a high-level allowance race, and she looks like the one to catch. Significantly on paper anyway, but again, that'll go as the fifth and penultimate leg in today's 7-figure jackpot Rainbow Six. We will have a horse probably in the range of maybe 4 to 5 or even money here. I could see Maverick Kitten being a touch over bet in this spot just because he looks so good on paper, and he's obviously the focal point for our conversation, and we'll go back to his last race. There's not a lot to see or say about this performance other than the fact that he just ran well losing for 40,000. And the horse, speaking of Louis Russell, who's got your best bet in Kunal a bit later today, he was sending out the gray horse with the red cap in Imperial Moment, who, I mean, you look at the odds, was a massive 1-2 favorite. Just a good effort last out for Maverick Kitten. And unless somebody steps forward, Ronnie, in this race, you know, it looks like he might just be a little too classy for these horses in for the 32K.
And a lot of people trying to read it. Oh, he ran for 40. Now he's dropping to the 32 level. It's not the case with Mike Maker. He just puts horses where they could win. You're getting Edgar Zayas in the saddle today. And as I mentioned, when I was showing you my Rainbow Six ticket to 5 Fake News, returning to the maiden claiming ranks after showing some early interest and fading when facing Special Weight Company in back-to-back outings. As I mentioned, this horse has run good in the claiming ranks and got some speed. I just added to this ticket for a safety net. Maverick Kitten, the one to beat, but I like Fake Muse. Didn't want to get beat by that horse.
End of this meet, which wraps up in late September. I am absolutely planning on doing more of a claiming all-star list as far as who ran the best, who impressed me the most, and we'll do that on the air and social media. And a big favorite to be number one in my list at this point of the season down here in the summertime is the Race 6 Bound Combination, who's going to be a pretty clear favorite in a race where a lot of people, I think, are going to expect him to get it done in the opening leg of the late pick 5. Now, I didn't single him just because there's always a part of me that wonders and maybe worries, well, is today the day he takes a little bit of a step backwards, because he's just been so good and he's been on such a steady ascent. And if that happens, maybe the 5, Christo Sky, who's probably a better turf horse, maybe he can make a race of it here. But Combination is going to be a clear and comfortable favorite, and deservedly so. Used a couple in the 7th. I prefer the 8, Yolanda's Pride. I just like the placement with her. And Aficionado's just been good in her last couple, routing for Patrick Biancone. 3 deep in a very competitive 8th race where Ralph Nix is sending out a couple, or Safi's got a couple, and then you've got one in there for Ralph Nix, one in there for Mike Maker. And I built this play around the loose on the lead for Miles, Violent Trick, who is stepping up, Ronnie. I mean, there's no question about it. Unequivocally, she is facing far better horses, but her dirt races, one turn mile down here from last winter on, have all been pretty good, and I just don't see anybody that's going to keep up with her early on.
Yeah, she looks like certainly the one to beat. And as I mentioned, I saved a little bit with Ali Z in that race, and we used the same 3 in race number 10 with the 6-9 and the number 12. That's a wide open race, and that's part of the Stronic 5 combination along with race number 8 today.
And Combination, meanwhile, has gone 7-8 with the addition of Blinkers. I can't remember. I say it every time he runs. I don't remember a horse who's turned things around on basically a 180 and has gone in a completely different or opposite direction than the ascension that this gelding by alternation has pulled. Here's his last start. I mean, every time, much like a French Quarter who ran here last week, and any time Combination's in, more often than not, I'm going to pull a replay of his just to give him the respect and acknowledgement that he deserves. And he's bounced around to seemingly every barn on the Gulfstream Park backstretch and threw it all through rising steadily in class. I mean, the result has basically stayed the same with this horse racking up one win photo after another. And he's going to get a great trip in this race, Ronnie. There's a ton of speed down towards the inside.
Yeah, and as you mentioned, he's been in a lot of barns. He's a reclaim today by Safi Joseph Jr. after posting his 4th consecutive victory and that optional claimer. Edgar Zayas Rice, he's the one to beat in there. I had some interest in the 2 Take Charge Dude, who's moved to the Peter Walder barn after the claim duel for the lead. speed. And I want to show you a stat on Peter Walter. This is an all-encompassing stat over the last 5 years. First after the claim, sprints on the dirt. He's 13 for 15, 26%, 54% in the money. 232 is the return investment after all those starters. I just think, personally, Peter Barn has really woken up the last couple of weeks, in my estimation. And everything he sends out seems to run well. It's going to have its running shoes on to beat combination today.
And, I mean, at some point is going to have to deal with Travi Boy. Is that a concern with those two potentially hooking up?
Yeah, I mean, that is part of the problem there. But, you know, like I said, for a second for the exactor, I think maybe this horse can hold on. And, you know, just race number six. You got a couple of scratches in there, the three and the seven, that compact field. It's combinations race to lose in there. But, you know, but maybe, you know, like we say all the time, Jace, you got to be out there and do it.
Yep, definitely. Race number seven is on the turf. These are three-year-old fillies. We've got a $30,000 to $25,000 claimer. I think the end is going to run well in this spot. You know, and she's got speed. I mean, that off the bat, and I'll send it to you, she may not get loose in this race with the one, let's be honest. And I think my top pick, the eight, Yolanda's Pride, will be up close and in that first flight. But I'm with you. I think the end is a major, major player.
Yeah, and I was looking for a little bit of a price. 10-1 in the morning line, goes back to the turf after returning from the layup. As you mentioned, set the pace, finished third, and would face in the same caliber. That was going that one-turn mile on the sealed sloppy track. Mark Cassie, Christian Torres. You know, I'm looking for the price. I personally thought La Russia was the horse to beat near for Amador Sanchez, but it's been sort of mired in second gear this year. Eight starts with 5 seconds in the third. And the reason I was looking for something a little different here and went with the end.
Aficionado has been okay of late. She stepped up her game, and at least seems that, to my eyes anyway, that she's leveled off and seems like a major player to me from the outside routing this afternoon for Patrick Biancone, who's got Diamond Oops running here. Assuming and fingers crossed A is okay with the weather, Ronnie, on Sunday. That open lead race came up a really solid field.
Yeah, our guys in our office, Ed Gray, was talking to him yesterday, and he said, you know, he's just staying close to home with his horses because of the situation around the world. Doesn't want his daughter to travel. And this horse would have been in Saratoga, but he's going to stay here and run at 6 furlongs. His grade one stakes place at 6 furlongs. He is the one to beat.
Yeah, no, I like him. I think he's going to run better as well off the loss to Eye of a Jedi. I just wonder how tight Patrick had the screws, so to speak. But again, that Sunday with Diamond Oops and Patrick and Andy Biancone, just major players with Aficionado. I like the placement here for the 8 Yolanda's Pride. I like those Florida bred races at a higher level that she's coming out of, and I think she'll run pretty well just dipping in for 30K. Moving on to the 8th, we'll stay on the turf, and we've got two in the mix for Safi, one for Maker, one for Ralph Nix. It's a very tricky little race here fairly late in the card, and evidently we've got your best bet, Ronnie, in Kunal, who, I mean, that's another sort of, aside from just having some high-profile trainers, which is a big deal, another major pre-race bullet line is the fact that you've got a number of horses coming out of the threshold race with Kunal back on July the 8th.
Yeah, you know, turning back to the mile up there, I thought a sharp local debut going the mile in the 16th. He tracked the pace. He finished second. Louis Russell is the trainer, handling the second start in the Sunshine State. And his horses, once they get a race over the track, even originally, run well. I didn't know what the morning line would be, and I thought this horse was going to be the favorite. To my surprise, 10-1. Now, let's play hardball. It's the one I thought had the biggest chance in here.
Yeah, and that horse will go from the rail. I know you got a stat for Mike Maker, right? Yeah, we got a Maker stat in this race. So, yeah, let's take a look at that. This horse hit off a 62-day layoff. So this begins basically like right on the cusp of where this horse is coming back from. Again, it's 62 days. So these are turf races at claiming turf races at Gulfstream. You've got a barn that has obviously, with close to 60 starters, has batted at a pretty lofty percentage.
Yeah, in the money 47% of the time, and a positive return investment, which I like. And that was just, I just wanted to see, because as you mentioned yesterday, Mike is winning everywhere. So I wanted to see how he did at Gulfstream Park. Not that we didn't know he did fantastic down here. Just a stat to put things into perspective.
Yeah, no, I like Let's Play Hardball, though. He can't make many mistakes in this race. It's an even field. Then you've got that threshold race with Kunal. I've got threshold second, and also have the 7 Dominate the Moment, who quietly has run some fine races on the turf for Alan Iwinski. I don't think that horse is out of that race by any means. Main track finale on this 10-race Friday, July the 31st, is our featured 9th race, and it's a good way to end the action on the dirt. just a solid field of horses, led, of course, by Violent Trick. And we'll show you her last start. She was coming in off a little bit of a layoff and a trainer change over to Todd Pletcher. Certainly was going up in class as far as who had had her and who currently has her, with Todd and his team putting the equipment on her and getting her tacked up. And here's basically the result. It took a lot of effort, both from Violent Trick and Edgar Zayas. I mean, she really endured a long drive, and there were a couple different junctures that looked like she might be in trouble. In fact, right here, looks like the five, Little Miss Hotshots, got her, but she dug in, couldn't have been any gamer. And I'd like to go into this race today, Ronnie, thinking, okay, this race, although a slim victory that we're looking at, was her first for Todd, off a layoff. I'd like to think not only is she maybe a bit better moving forward, a bit stronger, a bit fitter and all that stuff, I just, like I was saying with my late pick five, I don't see anybody running with her and matching strides early on.
Yeah, really hard-fought victory last time. I think she takes that jump forward today. I tried to be cute with Alize, who's wheeling back after returning for the layoff, moving to the Elizabeth Doble Barns, posted her second consecutive victory, so she's in good form. Victor LeBron, I'll take the cake. With me, I'll always take the cake if I get a chance. So I just thought they, you know, how you see this race, it goes through Violent Trick.
Yeah, but I'll take the cake. Is a major, major foe here. She's put up a very admirable career. I love the fact that she's by no biz like Showbiz as well. There just aren't that many. Always liked that horse for Nick Zito. She's been really good and defeated. We have not seen her basically since President's Day or President's Weekend back in the middle of February. She beat a good horse, fair and square last time out, Liza Starr.
Yeah, that was in the Lady Bird during February, coming off the bond. You know, Safi Joseph Jr., 26%, just about every stat, coming off that type of layoff, so I'm expecting that horse to run okay.
And the Nightcap, a turf race, again, one-fifth of today's 100K Stronic 5. The Friday last race is a three-lifetime 12-5 claimer. Our boy Evans is probably like the starting point as far as the dialogue goes as he gets back on his preferred surface for the 12-5. In the end, however, the speed of the 9 Fort King wound up winning me over.
Yeah, I mean, that one looks like you're going to have to come and get him for a trainer, Georgina Baxter, with MSCL Jaramillo. Our boy Evans for Mike Maker, going back to the grass. And young Raymond, I like this horse, but the post is a little tough going 5 furlongs.
Yeah, that is post number 12. No scratches to be had in the last, although we do have a couple on the program. And who better to send it to than the one and only Pete Aiello, who's coming up next.